It's really, it's hard to believe. You know, we came into the season with the goal of having the opportunity to compete for a Final Four. And then once you get there, you're competing for a national championship. And I really thought that we had the pieces to do that. And then when Asia Taylor's rehab is a lot longer than what we had anticipated, it wasn't as quick as we had anticipated. And the next thing you know, she's not going to be able to come back. Tia Gibbs was the same way. Both of those young ladies, we were anticipating to be back for the first practice. And then they're not. So now there's two players that both had started an extensive amount. And then you go into 11 games into the year, and Shante Dyer tears an ACL. Now we're down another post player. And it was starting to get real thin. And, you know, we played okay, but not great. Lost some tough games. And then we started to gel and get some things going. And then Monique Reed goes down after our Marquette game and tears a cartilage in the same knee that she had injured a year before. And she had that microfracture surgery that Greg Oden has had. And, you know, just her ability to be able to come back and play was something we knew. It was going to be a limited amount of minutes. We were going to have to make sure we didn't put her out there in practice too long. And she was doing okay until she went down. Then she misses 3 weeks. She gets evaluated by our doctors. And, you know, she knows that when this season's over, she's going to have to go back in for surgery again. And, you know, our doctors do a great job, our trainers do, and basically told her, we can do it now, and then you're finished, or you can just try to play, see how you handle the pain, and finish out the year. And Monique, there was no question in my mind what she was going to do, and that was she wanted to come back and play. And we've really tried to do a good job of playing her in games, not playing her in some games. You know, I had a lot of my staff when we went up to play at Syracuse with a chance to finish outright third in the league. I told them I'm not playing her. You know, I knew we had secured a double bye. And you have to be in the top four to do that. But my thoughts were, if we can give her an extra week of rest, that's what we're going to do. And we did. And I think it helped her in the long run. And right now, she's feeling good. I mean, she's sore. Her knee's swollen. We're going to take a few days to hopefully get the swelling down. But she played 33 minutes for us in a game last night that we needed her senior leadership and experience. You know, nobody expected us to be here, and that's the fun part of it. And, you know, as I've said before, I'm fortunate enough to have experienced this before, but it's all about the players. Monique Reed's the only one that's gone through this. And all she kept telling her teammates after the game was, this is such an awesome experience, you guys. It's something you'll never forget. And we're just trying to go out and continue this thing. I mean, our goal is not to just get to the Final Four now. We still have two games to try and go out and win, and that's their mindset at this point in time. So we like to spoil some things because it's not what everybody wanted. You know, the talk was Baylor. They're going to be there. Brittany's going to be there going for a second national championship, and we kind of spoiled that. And I think it took everybody by surprise. And then, I mean, I know what everybody thought, you know. So it was a fluke game. They go 16 of 24 from the three-point line. Because I promise you, you come to practice tomorrow, we couldn't do it without Emma Gardner. But we find a way to do it. And then, well, they're going to get beat by Tennessee. It's, you know, the traditional power. And our kids said, no, we're not either. You know, why stop now? And we figured out a way to get it done. No, I didn't rehearse that at all. It's just the feeling we got. You know, it was like you never felt like we got any respect. You know, we won our first two round games because we played at home. You know, but there were 15 other teams that played at home too. But we were the one that won because we had the opportunity to play at home. So it was never that we actually outplayed somebody or beat somebody. And that's where it just got to the point with our players, and I'm like, hey, nobody respects you. Nobody thinks you can do this. So let's go out. We have nothing to lose and have fun. And that's what they did.
Do you know anybody who had a bet down on you at 75-1? Or have you heard from any of them?
No, I do not. But I do know had a young lady I coached at Nebraska, Carson Mueller, that I just got a text from, an email from the day after our Baylor game. Just, you know, congratulating us and everything. And she said, hey, I sat down with my friend and we did our bracket. And she goes, and I'm not lying. I told her, I go, if there's anybody that can beat Baylor, it's Louisville. So she picked us in her bracket to win. And then I text her back last night. I was like, okay, let's be real now. Who did you really pick and who are your teams in the Final Four? And she said, no lie. My teams in the Final Four were Louisville, Cal, Notre Dame, and UConn. And I told her, you should have gone to Vegas. She could have made some money.
What about some of the other reactions you've gotten, text or anything?
Just a bunch of texts. Just people really excited for us. Probably the most enjoyable part of this entire trip was we had the opportunity to sit down, and I recorded Survive in Advance by Jonathan Hawk, the NC State story. And we watched that before our Baylor game. And then after the game, the next morning I wake up and I've got an email from Jonathan Hawk, because he did off the res with Shoney. And I had known him, so he sends it to me. And I just sent him a quick response back. Hey, I appreciate it. We watched Survive in Advance. The kids really enjoyed it. Because you all know, they weren't even born at that point in time. So some of them, we're having to explain what it is. You know, this is what you're going to watch. And he sent me a text back and said, I'll let Wittenberg know, he'll be excited. So I emailed him back and said, well, when you're telling him that, can you see if he'll call? And then within a half hour, I get an email back saying, yeah, here's his phone number. So that night we go back to prepare. We go back to our team meal. And I had him show just the national championship game of the story. And after it, we had our speakerphone set up, and the kids had no idea. And I said, hey, I've got someone that wants to talk to you just for a brief minute. And I dialed his number, picks up the phone. And I'm like, is Derek Wittenberg there? And our players were like, no, you got to be kidding me. And he got on and was just remarkable. I mean, just talked to our kids about he watched a Baylor game. He was going to watch the Tennessee game. Just about believing in yourselves, playing free, enjoy the experience. Take the pressure off of you and make sure you enjoy what you're doing and never forget it. And our kids took it to heart. So it was remarkable. It was just, it's so refreshing that someone like that took the time. Five minutes, but it meant a lot more than five minutes to our players.
And then Durant comes into the locker room. It seemed like he became a Louisville fan over the weekend.
He was great. I will say, you know, you see him on TV. I had the opportunity to go over and watch Angel play in the Olympics and had the chance to watch them one game. And you're seeing a player like that. And when he came in our locker room, it was just like it was anybody else. Just walked in there and was like, hey, congratulations. And, of course, our players went crazy. But they all got their pictures taken with them. And it was a very heartwarming time just to see somebody of his stature and celebrity status just spend 10-15 minutes just talking with the kids. And then we go out, we play last night, you know, we win, and he's down on the floor after the game. I mean, he came to both games, stayed for the entire game, and telling our kids what a great job they did. So I know they really enjoyed it. I'm not sure if the biggest moment was winning to go to the Final Four or meeting him. You know, it's a toss-up right now, but It was a great experience.
Did you give Courtney a hard time about the question
this Friday? She hit him good, boy. If you all didn't see it, she went to give Durant a hug, boy, and she connected with a left hook right in his jaw. And I made sure, though, last night she went up and found him. And then I said, why don't you go tell Kevin if you want a real bodyguard, you'll take care of it for him. And no, but they were great. They're absolutely great.
The lasting image was kind of the fight you guys had the whole weekend was we're not afraid.
And we had that, and also we had nobody believes in what you can do. So there was no pressure. I mean, we had no pressure on us at all, and we still don't. And that's how we're going to play through this entire Final Four. You know, we're going to try to play smart basketball, but at the same time, we're not going to hold back. I mean, we're taking some shots that most coaches probably would not think are good shots, and I'm not sure they are. But they believe in them. I mean, Sarah Hammond's step back three right in front of our bench was the slowest step back I've ever seen. And then she shoots it over Griner, and when it left her hand, I'm like, I think it's going in. And that was the kind of night it was. I mean, the two threes that Shoney and Antonita hit kind of almost back-to-back were from at least 26 or 27 feet. And nobody's expecting them to go in. So we're going to continue to play like that. That's how we played in last night's game. I mean, we're not a very deep team. You know, we play 9-10, but we're playing against teams that have 12 or 13. So we started to get tired last night. And our kids know it. I mean, teams are going to make runs at us, and we've just got to figure out a way to withstand it. Tennessee cuts it to three, and we just attack, and Shoney makes a layup, and then we come down, we get a stop again. Jude hits a three. Antonia makes a reverse layup. But we just kept attacking instead of worrying about, okay, we have the lead. We just have to maintain it.
You always talk about getting there as a program or being there as a program. To do this, have all the national attention, is that how you get there?
Oh, for sure. You know, you've got to be able to perform. And I think we've shown people now we are a program. It's not just a one team. It's not just this is what the 09 team did, and that's as far as they're going to go. I mean, you're looking at a program now that's been the two Final Fours in 5 years. I mean, besides your UConn and Notre Dame, Stanford, Oklahoma may have in the past 5-6 years. I mean, it's us. So I think it says a lot about what we're doing here. Our goal is to continue to build this, to continue to recruit players, and get back there.
Jeff, you talked about Monique's journey this season, but what will her legacy be, just how much she's grown up in this program as a ball girl and now the two Final Fours?
Well, I think right now, I think she's either tied or will have surpassed. She's tied right now, so when we play, she'll pass. So she will surpass Angel for games played. And she'll be the only player to date in this program that's played in two Final Fours and has, you know, had a significant impact her freshman year. It's not like she was just on the team at the end of the bench passing out water. I mean, she was a big part of it. So I think she'll have to go down for sure. Is one of the great players that's played here.
How big is the chip on this team's shoulder? Not only the disrespect of people not thinking you could do it, but even after you beat Baylor, as if there was disastrous on it. You got Robert Griffin the third kind of being critical of the way you guys went about it, yet you guys were the ones playing and Baylor was
one. Yeah, I mean the emails I've received about that, I'll never watch a Louisville team play. I'm a 63-year-old ex-coach, and I just you embarrass our game. I mean, they're comical after a while. And as I tell everybody, they sit there and they talk about, oh, this is what you did to Baylor. This is how you defended them. They scored 81 points. They averaged 81 points. We obviously didn't do that good of a job defensively. What everybody seems to forget about is we scored 82 points. No team in Brittany Griner's 4 years scored more points than we scored against them. You know, my comment, because Kim's been very critical of our players and our team, is I wouldn't be so concerned about what we were doing. What were you doing defensively? Because it wasn't working. You know, so at what point in time do you sit there and evaluate yourself instead of always trying to put blame on someone else? Because I've watched the game. It was a physical game. There's no question about it. But they do pay three people a pretty good amount of money to officiate it. So, you know, our kids were out there trying to compete, trying to be get in her space, trying to make it as difficult as we possibly could for her to score, and we did a great job of that.
Have you thought about incorporating more Blazers into your wardrobe? I know you mentioned it
No, I know. I mean, you know, I got my technical foul because I was outside the coaching box, they said. But I did learn that you can run up and down and rip off your clothes and it's okay. I mean, so I did. I told him, I said, I'm just going to go out and buy about four or five sport coats and just start tearing them off one after another and it's okay. But, you know, it's something, you know, I learned from that too. It probably wasn't very smart. But, you know, I'm thankful to our players to be able to step up there. And Monique made two unbelievable free throws after she just about airballed that first one on the one and one. She stepped up confident and makes both of them. Well, I think it's our entire team. You know, granted, we're having a lot more we've had a lot more success these past two games when you're talking about the Baylors in Tennessee than we have against Notre Dame and UConn. But our kids are starting to believe in themselves, and they're realizing you have to have a nothing was done bad about it, but I think it brings a lot of interest to it. It brings a spark to it. And when the emotions are running high, which they do in men's and women's basketball, there's going to be situations that occur like that. I mean, it's three out of four, and it's really five of eight when you got two men's teams playing in it, too. So I think the Big East speaks for itself. It reminds me of 06 when I was at Maryland when we had three teams from the ACC in the Final Four that year. So it's fun because you get to see people that you know, but at the same time, the beauty of the NCAA tournament is you're normally getting the opportunity to play someone you haven't played before. So we'll get the opportunity to play Cal in the first semifinal game. And if we're fortunate enough to be able to pull out a win with that, then we know we're going to be playing either Notre Dame or UConn.